इट्स डन सर नाउ।
ओके ओके आइट आगे।
ಎಲ್ಲರಿಗೂ ನಮಸ್ಕಾರ. ವೆಲ್ಕಮ್ ಟು ದಕ್ಷ ಲೀಗಲ್ ಆನ್ಲೈನ್ ಸೆಮಿನಾರ್. ಟುಡೇಸ್ ಟಾಪಿಕ್ ಈಸ್ ರಿಜೆಕ್ಷನ್ ಆಫ್ ಪ್ಲೈಂಟ್. ದಿ ಡಿಸ್ಟಿಂಗ್ವಿಶ್ಡ್ ಸ್ಪೀಕರ್ ಈಸ್ ಜಸ್ಟಿಸ್ ಎ.ಎನ್. ವೇಣುಗೋಪಾಲಗೌಡ, ಫಾರ್ಮರ್ ಜಡ್, ಹೈಕೋರ್ಟ್ ಆಫ್ ಕರ್ನಾಟಕ. ರಿಜೆಕ್ಷನ್ ಆಫ್ ಪ್ಲೈಂಟ್ ಈಸ್ ಆಫನ್ ಬ್ರಾಡ್ಲಿ ಕನ್ಸಿಡರ್ಡ್ ಆಸ್ ಎ ಪ್ರಿಮೆಚೂರ್ ಅಂಡ್ ಫೋರ್ಸಿಬಲ್ ಚೆಕ್ಮೇಟ್ ಆಫ್ ಫ್ರಿವಲಸ್ ಲಿಟಿಗೇಷನ್ಸ್. ಹೌವರ್, ದ ಪ್ರಿನ್ಸಿಪಲ್ಸ್ ಆನ್ ದಿಸ್ ಆಸ್ಪೆಕ್ಟ್ ಆರ್ ನಾಟ್ ವಿಥೌಟ್ ಗೈಡ್ಲೈನ್ಸ್. ದ ಟರ್ಮಿನೇಷನ್ ಆಫ್ ಪ್ರೊಸೀಡಿಂಗ್ಸ್ ಅಟ್ ದ ಥ್ರೆಶೋಲ್ಡ್ is guided by sound judicial principles evolved over a period of time. In a judicial system like ours, where delay in disposal of cases is a lingering problem, unscrupulous litigants can drag anyone to court and litigate on an issue, however frivolous it is, for years together. The civil courts would be completely helpless without a provision to terminate such litigation summarily. The provision to reject the plaint would come to the aid of the courts and to the rescue of the defendants. We shall learn more on this subject today. I shall call upon the distinguished speaker to take over. Over to you, sir.
Ellarigu namaskara. I am happy to participate in this webinar so that I can have a lot of interaction with my friends in the bar. After a long time, that too because of corona, we are not able to be in touch with each other. I am really happy to participate in this webinar and say a few things about this rejection of plaints and in exercise of the power under Order 7, Rule 11, CPC. I'll speak more from the perspective of the advocate's interest and the litigant interest rather than what the courts do or how the judicial officers should exercise their powers. My endeavor today, being the address to the members of the bar at large, my exercise would be to see that as many less plaints are rejected as is possible by strengthening the system, because ultimately the litigant suffers on account of this exercise of power if the elements as indicated in Order 7, Rule 11, A to F is met. Now, for that, I would request that kindly have a look to Section 9 CPC, which is in respect of suits in general and jurisdiction of courts. Section 9 CPC, I'll share it on the screen itself. It reads, "The court shall, subject to the provisions herein contained, have jurisdiction to try all suits of civil nature." There is no problem till here. Then, excepting suits of which their cognizance is either expressly or impliedly barred. This has a direct link or bearing to the provision under Order 7, Rule 11, D is concerned. Excepting suits of which their cognizance is expressly or impliedly barred. Now, this provision, if it is kept in mind, then I'll take you to chapter, I'll take you to sections 15 to 20 of CPC. 15 and 16 are in respect of suits to be instituted in a court of lowest grade competent to try them. Suits to be instituted in court of competent jurisdiction in the lowest grade, that is both territorial and pecuniary jurisdictions. Then section 20C recognizes the territorial jurisdiction of court, inter alia, where the cause of action wholly or in part arises and thus suit can be filed. Section 20, if you see, more particularly clause C, it says as to where the cause of action wholly or in part arises. Now, this cause of action has a direct bearing to Rule 11A of Order 7 CPC. Now, Section 9 refers to the 711D, and as far as this 20C is concerned, refers to cause of action wholly in part arises. So these things have to be kept in mind before proceeding further. Now, a suit commences, as all of us know, with the presentation of plaint, which contains inter alia statement of material facts constituting the cause of action and the relief claimed. So plaint should invariably contain the cause of action and the relief, and it should have the material facts of what nature? The material facts relating to the subject matter or the grievance of the party, and the infringement, if any, has to be stated therein without fail. Now, what is this cause of action? All of us know, is a bundle of facts to be pleaded and later proved to obtain the relief in the court. And for maintaining a suit, the accrual of cause of action is a sine qua non, that is for institution of the suit. Now, without a cause of action, suit cannot be instituted in whichever court it may be. And that's why it's the sine qua non for institution of the suit is the cause of action. Cause of action being the bundle of facts, material facts, and the invasion or infringement, if any, thereby by the opponent. Then, once the suit is instituted or the plaint is presented under Order 7, Rule 1, CPC, the court has an obligation to see whether various requirements of the first schedule refers to orders and rules, first schedule have been complied with or not. There you will find parties to the suit, then the material facts, the jurisdiction, all other aspects come into playing. Order one onwards, everything starts. Once the court completes that examination, preliminary examination rather, not a final, not in detailed analysis, then the regular procedure of issuing of summons, filing of written statement, issues, if any issues being framed, evidence being led in, arguments being heard, and the suit being decided one way or the other by passing a final judgment under Order 20 CPC comes into being. Now, before a suit could be tried and decided on its merit, there is this provision under Order 7, Rule 11 CPC, which is mandatory because it starts with the word, the claim shall be rejected in the following cases. So then A to F are the clauses. I'll come to them a little later. In the past more than about a decade, I have noticed that there is a rise in the matters relating to rejection of claims. Why? What is the reason? The reason appears to be lack of due diligence in the matter of preparation of the pleadings. Lack of due diligence on the part of the legal practitioners in the matter of preparation of the pleadings. How? Firstly, rules pertaining to the pleadings contained in Order 6 and Order 7 CPC being given a go by or being ignored. Secondly, loose, laconic, and or vague pleadings being filed. Thirdly, relevant statutes or statutory laws and the judicial dicta on the subject matter have not been examined, and the plane prepared and presented. These are the ills in the system, and the main contribution should stop at the door of the person who has presented a plaint which does not pass through the rigors of Order 7, Rule 11, CPC is concerned. It will be very sad to notice such a thing coming to being, because had the person who is approached to institute the suit read the papers and has found that there are laws which bar institution of a suit, instead of filing the suit and wasting judicial time or resources of both the client as well as the court, the appropriate remedy as is available under the relevant statute could have been availed of. Secondly, if there are judgments on account of which the relief cannot be obtained at all, judgments rendered by the apex court having presidential value under Article 141 of the Constitution, if that judgments are staring at the face before filing of the suit, then the ways and means of securing the rights of the party are seeing to it that the litigant who has approached for relief or sought the help of the legal practitioner to institute the suit being appropriately protected. Now, these things having not been kept in mind, that is, relevant statutes having not been examined, judicial dicta having not been noticed, and the relevant provisions of Order 6, under Order 7 having not been looked into, the plaints have been filed, and the rigors of Order 7, Rule 11, if it is not passed through, the courts have no other option than to nip the plaint in the bud. I'll tell you, for a judicial officer, it is painful to nip a plaint in the bud. This is what I have experienced on the bench. This is what my colleagues on the bench have also told me. Because people come to the court for a trial and determination of their rights. Now here, instead of the matter being tried, if it is choked on account of technicalities, it pains the heart of any judicial officer to pass an order at the threshold and negate the cause. And he cannot help it, because he is bound by the mandate of law, Order 7, Rule 11 being mandatory. He or she has no other option than to seek recourse to it and pass appropriate orders. In fact, not even an application is required from the defendant. It can be passed suo moto. The power can be exercised suo moto by the court, because it doesn't make any reference to either an application being filed or a pleading being filed by the opponent to show that the plaint suffers from any of the deficiencies as is indicated in Rule 11 of Order 7 CPC. Now, how to overcome this is the first aspect which we'll have to see, rather than going into the principles which have been deduced by the courts from time to time on this provision of law, that is Rule 11 of Order 7 CPC. I would take you to Order 6 CPC, Order 6 CPC, you can see on the screen, Rule 1, pleading shall mean plaint or written statement. Now kindly see Rule 2. Kindly see Rule 2. This is very important. Everybody has to keep this aspect in mind. Every pleading shall contain, it doesn't stop there, and contain only, the emphasis is contain and contain only, a statement in concise form of the material facts on which the party relies upon for his claim or defense, as the case may be, but not, see there earlier, shall contain and contain only here again, but not the evidence by which they are to be proved. This is the relevant part which is required. 2 and 3 may not be very relevant for our discussion today. I'll skip those aspects, but however, I would draw the attention of the listeners and viewers to this aspect of the matter. Every pleading shall contain and contain only what? A statement in a concise form of material facts on which the party pleading relies for his claim or defense, as the case may be, but not the evidence on which they are to be proved. So keep this in mind. Then rule 3 gives the form of pleadings. Forms in Appendix A, when applicable, and when they are not applicable, forms of the like character, as nearly as may be, shall be used for all pleadings. Now, number of friends do not have the habit of buying books. Now, there may not be need for buying books. At least they can subscribe to these e-libraries. They can get a lot of inputs therein. I would request them to, before filing a suit of whatsoever nature, to see what is there a forum prescribed? If so, what is the minimum thing that is reflected in the forum? Whether the client who has approached for help to prosecute his case before a court has the requisite material on the basis of which a plaint can be drafted and presented before the court for its consideration. Now 3A is in respect of forms of pleading in commercial courts. You can see at the end, pleading shall be in such forums, that is as prescribed by the High Court, because commercial courts in many places is the trial is by the High Court itself. That's why it refers to the High Court rules or rules practice directions for that purpose. Then rule 4 is also important. Particulars to be given. This has to be read along with rule 2. Particulars to be given where necessary. In all cases in which the party pleading relies on any misrepresentation, fraud, breach of trust, willful default or undue influence, and in all other cases in which particulars may be necessary beyond such are exemplified in the forms of aforesaid, particulars with the dates and items if necessary shall be stated in the pleading. So this read rule 2 along with rule 4, or rule 4 should go along with rule 2, and all these shall be stated in the pleading. Then with that we'll go to rule 6, condition precedent. You can see there, condition precedent. Any condition precedent, the performance or occurring of which is intended to be contested, shall be distinctly specified in his pleading by the plaintiff or defendant, as the case may be, and subject thereto an averment of the performance or occurrence of all conditions precedent condition precedents necessary for the case of the plaintiff or defendant shall be implied in his pleading. So this has a bearing as far as contractual matters are concerned, reciprocal obligations. This has to be kept in view. Once we complete this relevant aspects of Order 6, I will now take you to Order 7, CPC, which generally deals with the institution of plaints. So Order 7 generally deals with institution of plaints in various types of suits as enumerated therein. You may look into that. Then rule 1 is concerned, you will see the rule 1 is concerned, the plaint shall contain, mandatory, shall contain the following particulars. Then what is relevant for our purposes? Clause E, the facts constituting the cause of action and when it arose. This has a direct bearing to Order 7, Rule 11A is concerned. Then I, a statement of the value of the subject matter of the suit for the purpose of jurisdiction and court fees, so far as the case admits. This has a bearing for C, Clause C and D. class B and C, class B and C of Order 7 Rule 11. So under Rule 1, classes A and I have a relation to the subject matter which we are discussing, that is rejection of claims in excess of the power under Order 7 Rule 11 CPC is concerned. Then come to Rule 2, you find in respect of money suits, where plaintiff seeks recovery of money, the plaint shall state the precise amount claimed. This is a material fact. That's why shall state the precise amount claimed. Then coming to Rule 2A, where the interest is sought to be sought in the suit, what is to be done? Where the plaintiff seeks interest, the plaint shall contain a statement to that effect, along with the details set out under subrules 2 and 3, which are down below. Then 2 at the end, I'll only take, shall state the basis of that, that is the interest claim, shall state the plaintiff shall, where the plaintiff seeks interest, the plaint shall state the basis of that. Then subrule 3 is concerned, the pleading shall also state, then A, B, C, D, E, it is there. Everything is self-explanatory. I need not have to take you into all those aspects of the matter is concerned. Then Rule 3, if you see, where the subject matter of the suit is immovable property, suppose the relief is sought in respect of an immovable property, what is to be done? Where the subject matter of the suit is immovable property, the plaint shall contain a description of the property sufficient to identify it, that is mandatory. And in case such property can be identified by boundaries or numbers in the record of settlement or survey, the plaint shall specify such boundaries or the numbers. I would suggest even if there were to be any mistake in the numbers, if boundaries are there, that is sufficient. Please exercise your caution. I have seen plaints being filed without boundaries being stated in the plaint schedule or numbers being wrongly mentioned. Then Rule 4 is concerned, where the plaintiff sues as a representative, where the plaintiff sues in a representative character, the plaint shall not only, see this word, shall not only, that he has an actual existing interest in the subject matter, but that he has taken steps, if necessary, to enable him to institute the suit concerning it. This is in respect to Order 1, Rule 8, representative suits are concerned. Read with Section 91 of CPC, that is public nuisances and other related aspects. Then coming to Rule 5, this is also important. While drafting the plaint, this is not kept in view. Defendant's interest and liability to be shown. What right or how he is trying to. The plaint shall show the defendant is or claims to be interested in the subject matter and that he is liable to be called upon to answer the plaintiff's demand. So what kind of claim is being put forth? If it is within the knowledge of the plaintiff, then the plaint shall show that defendant is or claims to be interested in the subject matter and that he is liable to be called upon to answer the demand made by the plaintiff, and that becomes a tribal issue is concerned. That becomes the cause of action is concerned. Then Rule 6, grounds of exemption from limitation law, where the suit is instituted after expiration of the period prescribed by law of limitation. A suit can be instituted also after the expiry of period of limitation. The plaint shall show the ground upon which exemption from such law is claimed. Now, if exemptions are available under any statute, you have to state. Or exemptions are there on factual aspects itself that you have to state. Suppose it is 3 years, and suppose instead of a particular article in the Limitation Act under the Schedule of Limitation Act being attracted, if it is a residuary provision which has to be looked into, you will have to narrate the facts. And on that aspect of the matter, I'll take you to a recent judgment which has a very important bearing. Now, here you will have to keep in view Section 4 of the Limitation Act in particular. Suppose now many of the suits must have been barred by limitation, that is starting from March 24th till the end of September or whatever it is, something may happen. So the fact why he could not institute the suit has to be stated, according to me, in the plaint itself. All that reasons, provided that the court may permit the plaintiff to claim exemption from law of limitation on any ground not set out in the plaint, if such ground is not inconsistent with the ground set out in the plaint. Then that's why you will have to look into limitation aspect also, that is the nature of suit, the period when it began, what is the period available, all that you will have to state it. You have to keep in mind the sections 1 to 29 of the Limitation Act, as well as the articles under the schedule therein. Then Rule 7 is concerned. If it says relief to be specifically stated, every plaint shall state specifically the relief which the plaintiff claims, either simply or in the alternative, if there is an alternative prayer also, and it shall not be necessary to ask for general relief, general or other relief, which may always be given by the court, given as the court may think just, to the same extent as if it had been asked for, and the same rule shall apply to any relief claimed by the defendant in his written statement, that is either a set off or a counterclaim, as the case may be. Then coming to Rule 9, procedure on admitting the plaint. This has a bearing, this has a link to Order 7, Rule 11, B and C is concerned, where the court orders the summons to be served on the defendant in the manner provided under Rule 9 of Order 5. It will direct the plaintiff to present as many copies of the plaint in plain paper as there are defendants within 7 days from the date of such order, along with the requisite fee for service of summons on the defendants. This has a bearing on these two duplicate copies being liable to be produced, as well as payment of court fee or the process fee, as the case may be. I'll come to that aspect a little later. Now, from here, we go to Order 7, Rule 11. I'll deal with it in a little detail, a little later, but however, I'll only say what is relevant. Rejection of plaint. The plaint shall be rejected in the following cases, which have been enumerated in clauses A to F is concerned. We'll come back later for that aspect, because that is the meat of our discussion today. Then from here, you can go to Rule 13 under Order 7, where rejection of plaint, that is, if a power has been exercised under Rule 11, plaint has been rejected, that does not preclude presentation of a fresh plaint. When rejection of a plaint on any of the grounds herein before mentioned, that is 11 is concerned, shall not of its own force preclude the plaintiff from presenting a fresh plaint in respect of the same cause of action. Suppose the cause of action has not been made clear there, the plaint suffered from the deficiencies which attracted the mischief of orders, Rule 11 of Order 7, then that doesn't prevent a fresh plaint being filed. And that has been made clear by the Supreme Court in a judgment reported in 1997, 10 SEC 192. It is a very small judgment, very short judgment. I'll take you to that. 1997, 10 SEC, page 192. Left it all. The pan, very old. 1997, 10 SEC, you can see here now, it is just 5 paragraphs only. First 1 and 2 we are not concerned. Heard plaintiff appellant, heard counsel of parties, the plaintiff appellant had filed a suit earlier which was rejected under Order 7, Rule 11. That was in the year 1984. In the year 1986, he filed a fresh suit on the same cause of action. The second suit has been dismissed by the trial court as barred by the order rejecting the plaint in the earlier suit. An appeal preferred against the order has been dismissed by the High Court. In our opinion, the courts below were not right in holding that the present suit is barred by virtue of the order rejecting the earlier suit. Order 7, Rules 13 reads as under. I'll skip that because I already read it. Then 5, in view of this set clear rule, we hold that the present suit is not barred by the earlier order rejecting the plaintiff in the earlier suit. We express no opinion on the other question. The trial court may consider expedited disposal of the suit according to law. The appeal is allowed accordingly. So this Rule 13 comes to the aid of those persons whose plaint has been rejected under Rule 11 of Order 7 in case the suit is instituted on the same cause of action. Take note of this rule as well as this judgment and see to it that the injustice, if any, done to the client earlier is not perpetuated, whether and the client is relieved of the pain which he must have undergone by institution of the first suit, if possible, within the period of limitation, or take whatever recourses that are available to you. Now, with this, I'll take you to Rule 14. Rule 14, where it says, production of documents on which the plaintiff sues or relies. Where the plaintiff sues upon a document or relies upon a document in his possession or power in support of his claim, he shall enter such documents in a list and shall produce in court. Now, it is not only the plaint documents, even the suit document or the documents produced along with the plaint can be read while considering the application filed under Order 7, Rule 11, CPC, or while exercising the power under Order 11, Rule 11, CPC by the court, suo motu. That's why this document, production of this document under Rule 14 is mandatory, that is, shall produce in court when the plaint is presented by him and shall at the same time deliver the document and a copy thereof to be filed with the plaint. So it shall be delivered as well as a copy thereof shall also, the original should be produced in the court and a copy shall be filed along with the plaint. Then, wherever any such document is not in possession or power of the plaintiff, he shall, wherever possible, state in whose possession or power it is. Then 3, a document which is ought to be produced in court by the plaintiff when plaint is presented ought to be entered in the list to be added or annexed to the plaint, but is not produced or entered accordingly, shall not without the leave of the court be received. With the leave of the court, it can be received. On that aspect, there are two judgments of Justice Kumar in Karnataka High Court. We can have a look into them. That takes care of the situation. Now, these are the relevant provisions as far as pleading is concerned, vis-a-vis Order 7, Rule 11, which any legal practitioner who wants to institute a suit has to keep in mind. This is mandatory. These provisions, what I have read out, are mandatory. If there is a lapse on the part of the legal practitioner in keeping these provisions in view, then certainly, that is Section 9, read with Sections 15 to 20, read with Order 6 and Rule 17, Order 6 and Order 7, the relevant rules which I have read out, if not kept in view, there may be scope for the plaint being rejected for want of cause of action or because of barred by law. Law includes not only the statutory law, but also the judicial dicta. That is what the Supreme Court has held recently. Judicial decisions of the court, binding decisions of the court. If there is a bar, then that also gets attracted under Rule 11D is concerned. Now let us go back to Order 7, Rule 11, which is the topic for our discussion today. Rule 11 has six subclasses. Plaint shall be rejected in the following cases. A, it does not disclose a cause of action. I'll come back to it a little later. B, where the relief claimed is undervalued and the plaintiff, kindly see, on being required by the court to correct the valuation within time fixed by the court, fails to do so. Means the court has directed the correction of the valuation within the time to be fixed by the court and there is failure to do so. Then second one is where the relief claimed is properly valued but the plaint is written upon paper insufficiently stamped, and the plaintiff, on being required by the court to supply the requisite stamp paper within a time to be fixed by the court, fails to do so. This B and C have to be read together. I'll deal with B and C first before going to A and D. A and D may take a little more time. That's why I'll take B and C first. There have to go to the other provisions also. Here you will see it is, one is undervaluation. As far as undervaluation is concerned, normally this is not resorted to suo motu by the court. Normally, if the defendant comes, raises the plea that the suit has not been properly valued and the requisite court fee has not been paid, what happens is the Court Fees Act mandates that to be taken or that to be decided as a preliminary issue on which trial takes place. Thereafterwards, the finding is recorded. Once finding is recorded, suppose if it is found that there is undervaluation or the requisite court fee has not been paid, then the suit will be directed to be valued properly. And if it is within the jurisdiction of that court, the plaint will be retained. If it is not within the jurisdiction of that court, the plaint will be for presentation before the proper court or the appropriate court, as the case may be, having pecuniary jurisdiction. Then in that event, within the time required by the court, directed by the court, the requisite court fee has to be made good. Then the other one is a analogous provision, B and C. Here, you will have to examine B and C vis-a-vis the proviso appearing thereunder. Proviso says, after clause F, provided that the time fixed by the court for the correction of the valuation or supplying of the requisite court fee shall not be extended unless the court, for reasons to be recorded, is satisfied that the plaintiff was prevented by any cause of an exceptional nature from correcting the valuation or supplying the requisite stamp paper, as the case may be, within the time fixed by the court, and that refusal to extend the time would cause grave injustice to the plaintiff. So this proviso has to be read along with section 149 of CPC. 149, if you were to see, is specifically with regard to the power to make up the deficiency of court fee, section 149 CPC. Power to make up deficiency of court fee is the heading. However, I'll take you to that aspect of the matter. Here, 148 and 149 both may be kept in view, not 148A. 148 is enlargement of time, and 149 is power to make up deficiency of court fee. 148 is a general provision, 149 is a special provision. Both may be kept in view. This 149 is concerning the making up of deficient court fee and related aspects. 148 is general power of enlargement of time. On this aspect, I would request the attention of the viewers as well as listeners to have a look of the two judgments, or one judgment itself would be sufficient, apart from section 11 of Court Fees and Suit Valuation Act, that is reported in 2009, volume 9, SEC 173. 2009, volume 9, SEC 173. The relevant paragraphs are 17, 23, 33 to 38. It is on the screen. This is with regard to the discretionary power under section 149. Here also, rupee 1 was paid on the plaint as court fee, few years later, or I can say more than a decade later, the deficit portfolio was made good. Still, the provision being there and power having been exercised and that having not been questioned, the Supreme Court said, yes, the moment the deficit court fee is made good in terms of the direction issued by the court, it goes to the date of instruction of the suit itself. So paint cannot be rejected under Order 7, Rule 11C is concerned. Para 17, I'll take you to Para 17. Payment of court fee, furthermore, is a matter between the state and the suitor. Indisputably, in the event a plaint is rejected, the defendant would be benefited thereby. But if an objection is to be raised in that behalf, or an application to be entertained by the court at the behest of the defendant for rejection of plaint in terms of Order 7, Rule 11C of the court, several aspects of the matter are required to be considered. Once an application under Section 149 is allowed, Order 7, Rule 11C of the court will have no application. If you make an application for extension under 149, and if that is granted, then the mischief of Order 7, Rule 11 is taken away. The teeth of Order 7, Rule 11C gets evaporated. Now come to Section 2, Para 27. Para 27 says, here a wrong provision of law was quoted and relief is sought. And thereafters, something has happened. Kindly see here, para 27. Section 148 of the code is a general provision and Section 149 is special. First application should have been filed in terms of Section 149 of the code. Once the code granted time for payment of deficit court fee within the period specified, therefore, it would have been possible to extend the same by the court in exercise of power under Section 148 of the court. Only because wrong provision was mentioned by the plaintiff, the same, in our opinion, by itself would not be a ground so and so. We are not concerned with it. Then come to Para 33. The question which survives for consideration is as to what is the scope of Section 149 of the court. Then few judgments of the Supreme Court are quoted from Para 35 to 37.
Sir, can you speak a bit loudly or come close to the mic? Because
Okay.
Some people say they're not very audible.
Okay. Then Para 33 is with regard to the question which survives for consideration is as to what is the scope of Section 149 of the court, and the scope has been found out in four judgments which have been mentioned from Paras 35 to 38 are concerned. I will not take you into all those things. Time may not permit us to go in that detail. Kindly have a look into them. Then the court doesn't find any scope for interference. Then the order passed by the trial court refusing to reject the plaint because of the delay in filing of payment of court fee on account of an order passed extending the period is maintained and the appeal was dismissed. So this judgment will be very handy as far as clauses B and C of Rule 11 of Order 7 CPC is concerned. Please make a note of it and deal with it or make use of it when you may require the required assistance in the form of a case law as a judicial dicta is concerned. However, in spite of 148 and 149, the maximum period being 30 days prescribed under Section 148. Now, we can also make use of the omnibus provision, that is 151, where you are not able to secure the relief under 148 in case there is a genuine difficulty for the client to make good the requisite court fees concern. Then after covering B and C, I'll go to clause E of Order 7, Rule 11. Clause E, which says, plaint shall be rejected where it is not filed in duplicate, or clause E, where the plaint is not filed in duplicate. For this, you will have to see Rule 9 of Order 7. And normally, these being curable defects, not being mandatory, the courts extend time. One has to overcome only A and D successfully. The rest of the things could be managed. They are flexible, and that inures to the benefit of everybody. Clause E should be read with Order 7, Rule 9, so that the mischief can be averted or avoided. Then F is concerned where the plaintiff fails to comply with the provisions of Rule 9. That again, Order 7, Rule 9 itself, if there is a failure on the part of the plaintiff to comply with that, then again, you have to fall back upon sections 148 and 149 CPC. So with that, we have completed the residuary provisions under Rule 11, residuary clauses under Rule 11 of Order 7 CPC. Now what remains is Order 11, Rule A and D therein. Now A is concerned, it is where it does not disclose a cause of action. Where it does not disclose a cause of action. Now, to find out whether the plaint discloses a cause of action or not, the settled legal position is, in a ketten of decisions by the Apex Court, that the plaint should be read in entirety or as a whole to find out whether it discloses a cause of action or not, to ascertain whether the same constitutes material facts involving tribal issues. Now, if it is read as a whole or in entirety and not dissecting any sentences or paragraphs, and if it conveys that the material facts or the grievance of the plaintiff has been stated, how the plaintiff's rights have been sought to be invaded or infringed by the defendant are forthcoming, if they can become a subject matter of an issue, or an issue can be raised on the way with reference to those elements are concerned, then the cause of action does exist. As you all know, as far as rural pleadings are concerned, we are in Bangalore, we may not have that deficiency. As far as rural pleadings are concerned, there will be some deficiency, there may not be clarity, there may be some amount of confusion or particulars not being there. Though material facts are available, one may find that there may be a deficiency in the matter of statement of the cause of action is concerned. I would say, if the plaint, when it is read in entirety or as a whole, and if it could be gathered that the rights of the plaintiff have been stated, how that rights of the plaintiff have been sought to be interfered or invaded or infringed by the defendant have also been stated, and on what date or what happened are also forthcoming in the plaint, then that does constitute a cause of action. It could become a subject matter of an issue which can go for trial. And if it can be inferred that there is a disputed question which requires to be tried, then Order 7, Rule 11 has no application at all, is what I would say. For this, you will have to, what is the role of the courts here? Role of the courts is to understand the underlying object of this provision first. That is, the plaint shall be rejected in the following cases, meaning thereby it can be even so motto by the court, the underlying object being that if in a suit, no cause of action is disclosed, that is, material facts are not forthcoming, the infringement of the rights of the plaintiff are not to be seen, or from the statements made in the plaint, there is a statutory bar to entertain the suit, then instead of wasting the judicial time, wasting the judicial resources, which are scanty, having regard to the inflow of cases and the courts being not so many for catering to the need of the litigants, the judicial time has to be preserved, and that is the reason the sham litigation has to be nipped in the bud. And with that in view, that being the underlying principle behind this Order 11 rule. Rule 11 of Order 7 CPC, the courts exercise their power. Now, whether it is mandatory for them to do it, is mandatory or obligatory on the part of the courts to do it, is an aspect which has to be borne in mind. A 7-judge bench of the Supreme Court, in the case reported at 1978 to SEC 500, at para 3, has said it is obligatory on the part of the court to do that job or exercise its power. This is Neelam Sanjeev Reddy's, the former president, case, wherein at para 3 it has been said. Six lines from the bottom. It is obligatory upon the court to reject it outright and not to waste any more time upon a plaint or a petition if the provisions of law bar are shown to bar the proceedings. Indeed, it is not even necessary to issue a notice to any opposite party or parties in such a case. This is by a 7-judge bench. This has not been watered down subsequently. In fact, it has been reiterated again and again. So that's the reason why it has to be exercised. That is the obligation of the courts are concerned. Then, in a judgment reported at 2005 volume 7 SEC 510 at para 23, third sentence, or I'll read the earlier two sentences also. Rule 11 of Order 7 lays down an independent remedy made available to the defendant to challenge the maintainability of the suit itself, irrespective of his right to contest the same on merits. It is an independent remedy apart from the decision on merits. The law ostensibly does not contemplate any stage when the objections can be raised, and also does not say in express terms about the filing of a written statement. Instead, the word shall, that is under Rule 11, shall, is used clearly implying thereby that it casts a duty on the court to perform its obligations in rejecting the plaint when the same is hit by any of the infirmities provided in the four clauses of Rule 11, even without intervention of the defendant. Now, kindly see here, ensure intervention of the defendant or application of the defendant or submission of the defendant is unnecessary. It can act on its own and decide the matter. Then, however, this has a limited application, is the way it has been understood by the Supreme Court in a judgment reported at 2008 12 SEC 661 at para 21, you will find such a statement of law having been made that it has a limited application. Para 21. Order 7, Rule 11D of the Code has limited application. Mark these words, has limited application. I want the legal practitioners to save the plaint and make it sure that it goes for a trial. That should be the way a legal practitioner should conduct before the court, whether in one case he may appear for the plaintiff, in the other case he may appear for the defendant. But howsoever it is, we being professionals, if the profession has to be respected, if the clients have to repose in the system or have to repose trust in the advocate community is concerned, it should be ensured that the plaints are not rejected at the threshold. It is an obligation on the part of the legal practitioner who is approached by a layman or a man who is not well versed in law to assist him in getting his rights redressed before a court of law, should see to it that the plaint is filed in a proper forum, keeping in view Section 9, Order 6, and Order 7 provisions of CPC, and thereafter take the matter to trial. Let the court decide the matter on its merit. That should be the endeavor of every advocate. Maybe if one appears on the opposite side, he may show that the plaint suffers from all these aspects of the matter. But howsoever, as I said, we may appear in one case for the plaintiff, in the other case we may appear for the defendant. Our primary duty is to see that the court decides the matter on its merit rather than the matter being thrown out at the threshold itself. Then para 21, Order 7, Rule 11D of the code has a limited application. It must be shown that the suit is barred under any law. Such a conclusion must be shown from the averments made in the plaint. Different clauses in Order 7, Rule 11, in our opinion, should not be mixed up. These are very strong words. These should be brought to the notice of the court before which the matter is taken up for consideration. It should not be mixed up. Whereas in a given case, an application for rejection of the plaint may be filed on more than one ground specified in various subclauses thereof, a clear finding to that effect must be arrived at. What would be relevant for invoking Clause D of Order 7, Rule 11 of the Code are the averments made in the plaint. For that purpose, there cannot be any addition or subtraction. So it should be the averments as they are appearing in the plaint has to be seen or read, and not any additions or subtractions are being interpreted in a manner which suits the convenience of the opponent or otherwise also. So these are this is another aspect of the matter which should be kept in mind. Then I'll take you to a decision in 2003, Volume 1, SEC, at para 16, as far as this clause. E and F of the this rule is concerned, Rule 11 is concerned, clauses E and F of rule. You should have brought it to your notice there itself. I'm sorry. There's some overlapping or omission. This is Salem Advocates Bar Association second case after certain amendments were incorporated subsequently in 2000. Then here it says, para 16, our attention has been drawn to Order 7, Rule 11, to which clauses E and F have been added, which enable the court to reject the plaint where it is not filed in duplicate or where the plaintiff fails to comply with the provisions of Rule 9 of Order 7. Earlier, there were only four clauses. After these amendments, there are six clauses now. This is E and F. It appears to us that the said clauses being procedural would not require the automatic rejection of the plaint at the first instance if there is any defect as contemplated by Rule 11E or non-compliance as referred to in Rule 11F. The court should ordinarily give an opportunity for rectifying the defects, and in the event the same being not done, the court will have the liberty or the right to reject the plaint. So granting of time for compliance of clauses B, C, E, and F are permissible. They are procedural in nature. They don't have that rigor of clause A and D are concerned. Clause A, if it were to go, it is on account of lack of proper pleading in terms of the provisions contained in Order 6 and Order 7 CPC. The relevant rules have already read out to you. And if it is on account of Clause D, that is barred by any law, meaning thereby the person who instituted the suit has not even bothered to see what Section 9 CPC says. When a civil suit has to be filed, which is the court which has the jurisdiction, has to be seen whether the civil suit is maintainable or not with reference to Section 9 has to be seen, and where it has to be instituted also has to be seen. One cannot go by his routine practices. There are a number of statutes which are being brought into force, are legislated and brought into force, which are taking away the general jurisdiction of the civil courts are concerned and conferring power on the tribunals or special courts as the case may be. And thereby there is bar of jurisdiction of the civil courts to a certain limited extent, that is not to exercise a general jurisdiction and in the form of entertaining the suits and granting decrees are concerned. That's why any advocate who desires to institute a suit should first find out whether in respect of the nature of suit which I am contemplating, whether there is any bar under any other statute, or is there a judicial dicta which comes in the way of the plaint being presented and relief being sought for the claimant is concerned. That should be the endeavor of the person who is approached for relief by the litigant public are concerned. Then, as far as this judicial dicta is concerned, you will find a judgment in 2018, 13 SEC 480. The judgments passed by the Supreme Court, which are binding, if were to bar the entertaining of suits, are held as not maintainable, suits of such nature are not maintainable, that can be also brought within the mischief of Clause D of Rule 11 CPC, Rule 11 of Order 7 CPC. Here, kindly go to Para 32. I'm only referring to the later judgments, not the earlier judgments. Later judgments. Para 32, after referring to the earlier case law, we are in agreement with you taken by the Allahabad, Gujarat, Bombay and Jharkhand High Courts in the aforementioned four decisions, which in our opinion is the proper interpretation of the expression of law occurring in Clause D of Order 7, Clause D of Rule 11 of Order 7 of the court. This answers the first submission of the Learned Counsel for the respondents against the respondents. This is the law means here, it is the limitation that was discussed. As far as limitation is concerned, there is a recent decision which is by a three-judge bench. I just wanted to say something. Now, because of this COVID, instead of these matters being decided by two-judge benches, they are being decided by three judges benches. Almost every bench is a three judge bench now. This becomes the binding judgment rather than what has been held earlier. So now whether this becomes a boon or bane, I do not know. This COVID situation relating to constitution of larger benches to decide matters, whether they become boon or bane is a matter which we'll have to examine a little later. We'll have to see with the passing of time how this happens. Earlier judgments on most of the judgments are, I can say, almost 99% of the judgments under Order 7, Rule 11 are by two judge benches, except one or two rare cases. And one is Neelam Sanjeev Reddy, which I read out in the context of election petition. Of course, vis-a-vis the provisions of Rule 11 of Order 7 is concerned. Now, here is a suit filed in respect of a monetary transaction that you will find in 2020 SEC Online SC 482. 2020 SEC Online SC 482. The decision is in COVID period only. You will find about half a dozen judgments in COVID period relating to this provision. This is 5th June 2020. Now, kindly see para 3. Plaintiff came to be rejected by the trial court under Order 7, Rule 11D of CPC on the ground it is barred by law of limitation. Here, the facts are that the bank had debited certain amounts from the account, which was noticed after expiry of 3 years period. Then some correspondence took place. Then the bank did not heed for the demands made in the correspondence is concerned. The suit was instituted after about 5 years, half the expiry of 3 years period of limitation is concerned. However, having regard to the plain governments, it was treated as a disputed question of fact. The judgments of the trial court, first appellate court, and the second appellate court were reversed by the Supreme Court and matter related back for trial. And very interesting question. You can go through this judgment. It is a lengthy judgment, quoting the pleadings also as well as the findings also. Come to now para 7. The central question is whether the plaint as filed by the appellant could have been rejected by invoking Order 7, Rule 11D of CPC. Indeed, Order 7, Rule 11 of CPC gives ample power to the court to reject the plaint if from the averments in the plaint, it is evident that the suit is barred by any law, including law of limitation. The position is no more recent than their lordships refer to the decision in the case of Ram Prakash Gupta, which has cited number of earlier precedents. It goes up to para 8. In para 9, their lordships take into consideration a later judgment to which Honorable Justice Kanvilkar was also a party, which has been referred to in para 9. Then para 10. Bold letter. Keeping in mind the well-settled legal position, we may now proceed to analyze the arguments in the plaint as filed by the appellant to discern whether it was a fit case for rejection of the plaint under Order 7, Rule 11, D of CPC. As noticed from the trial court judgment, it is evident that the trial court did not make any attempt to analyze the plaint in the manner predicated in the aforesaid decisions. Even the district court dealing with the first appeal and the high court with the second appeal omitted to do so. It is the bounden duty of the court to examine the plaint as a whole and not selected arguments therein. For that, we need to advert to the arguments in the plaint, paragraphs 8 to 15 of the plaint, which according to us are relevant arguments to the following are concerned. Now you see here in para 8, the facility was extended with effect from 1/4/1997. And somewhere in the month of July 2000, it was noticed that there was a charging of interest or commission at the rate of rupees 4,000 on local checks or drafts. And that was objected to. That was detected in the year 2000, that you will find it in para 9. Thereafter, correspondence was undertaken with the bank. That's all stated in the bold paragraphs, that is 11 and 13. Then a reply came in the year 2003. It is a monetary suit. Then the suit was instituted somewhere in 2007, which you will find in para 12. After referring to all that, come to now para 15. No, para 14. Thus understood, the letter dated 8/5/2002 sent by the manager of the respondent bank at best be reckoned as accrual of the cause of action to the appellant to sue the respondent bank. It is then stated the appellant received a communication dated 19/9/2002. That is all on the subject. Come to the last paragraph of that. Last sentence of that paragraph. Resultantly, the question of, reckoning the dates, the plaint was filed on 2005. That is, though the deductions were made up to 2000, 5 years later, the suit was filed. Resultantly, the question of rejecting the plaint under Order 7, Rule 11, DCPC did not arise. Here, the lordships take into consideration the finer aspects. The expression used in Article 113 of 1963 Act, that is Limitation Act, is when the right to sue accrues. It is not when first accrues. This is the residuary provision. 113 is residuary provision, which is markedly distinct from the expression used in the other articles in the first schedule, in the first division of schedule dealing with the suits, which unambiguously refer to the happening of a specified event. Whereas Article 113 being a residuary clause and which has been invoked by all the three courts in this case does not specify happening of a particular event as such, but merely refers to the accrual of cause of action on the basis of which the right to sue would accrue. This is the statement made, and the statement has to be read as it is and not to be dissected. That is what the court said. Then para 16, their lordships make out this first cause of action to accrue, and continuing breaches and torts are concerned. Then in para 17, they differentiate between articles 58 and 113 are concerned. That is description of the suit, period of limitation, the period within which it should be brought. Article 58, to obtain any other, it is in respect of declaration suits, they are shown. To obtain any other declaration, 3 years when the right to sue first accrues. Whereas in 113, any suit for which no period of limitation is provided elsewhere in this schedule, 3 years when the right to sue accrues. This was latched on, that is right to sue accrues, and the relief was granted, which you will find in para 21. Para 18, I'll take you. It is a citation which has been quoted from Khatri Hotels. 18, at the end of that quoted part in bold, you will find, if a suit is not covered by any specific article, then it would fall within the residuary article. In other words, the residuary article is applicable to every kind of suit not otherwise provided for in the schedule. So you will have to examine the applicability or otherwise of all these things. Now, para 21 is the ratio. It is well-established position that the cause of action for filing a suit would consist of bundle of facts. Further, the factum of suit being barred by limitation ordinarily would be a mixed question of fact and law. Even for that reason, invoking Order 7, Rule 11, CPC is ruled out. So if it is a disputed question of fact and law, then application or attraction of the mischief under Rule 11 of Order 7 is ruled out. This is how they make out the case and hold that the courts have committed mistake. Then para 30. Para 29, I'll take you. Taking overall view of the matter, therefore, we are of the considered opinion that decisions in trial court, first appellate court and high court, in the fact situation of the present case, rejecting the plaint in question under Order 7, Rule 11, DCPC cannot be sustained. The reason is, though the cause of action arose in 2000, suit was instituted in 2005 because there was correspondence undertaken. In a money suit, the last payment made is the one wherein the cause of action accrues. Here, since the correspondence was being undertaken, the bank had replied in 2003. The suit having been filed in 2005. It was prima facie held to be within the period of limitation. However, it was made a subject matter of trial, which you will find in para 30. In view of the above, appeal succeeds and plaintiff stands restored to the file of the trial court to its original number for being processed in accordance with law. All contentions available to both parties are kept open, including the issue of limitation, to be decided along with other issues on the basis of a plea taken in the written statement and the evidence produced by the parties in that behalf and influenced by the observations found. So this is how it has been dealt with. This being a larger bench judgment, kindly make use of it. Somebody may thank COVID, somebody may curse COVID on account of this fact situation. Now, to sum up, I would say the object of this provision, or underlying object of clause A of Rule 11 or clause D of Rule 11 of Order 7 CPC, is that if no cause of action is disclosed or the suit is barred by limitation or any other law under Rule 11D, the court would not permit the plaintiff to unnecessarily protract the proceedings in the suit. In such a case, it would be necessary to put an end to the sham litigation so that further judicial time is not wasted. This is one aspect. Then duty of the court is to determine whether the plaint discloses a cause of action by scrutinizing the arguments in the plaint, read in conjunction with the documents relied upon, and also to find out whether the suit is barred by any law, irrespective of whether defense is taken in that behalf or not by the opposite party. Then bar of law is concerned, how it has to be examined. You can see that it is with reference to the statutory law or judicial dicta, as the case may be, and those have to be deciphered by the counsels who appear for the parties in the lessee's concern. Howsoever, for examining the attraction or otherwise of the mischief under Rule 11 of Order 7 CPC, no defense or no part of the case of the defendant is required to be considered. It is only the plaint, the statements made in the plaint, and the documents accompanying the plaint could be looked into and not otherwise. Then the other aspect is that provisions of Order 7 Rule 11 being mandatory, the court has no option, and if the mischief is attracted, it has to nip the case in the bud, and that will be very, very sad day if a plaint is nipped in the bud on account of not the default of the party, but on account of deficiency on the part of the practitioner or the person who presented the plaint on behalf of the client. If suppose it is barred by law, party cannot be expected to assist the lawyer as to what the law is. It is the duty of the lawyer to find out what the law is. Even if that elementary duty has not been carried out, then I feel it is a sad day. The person has to definitely express regret for having allowed such a situation to come into being. As far as cause of action pleading is concerned, if there is any shortage of materials, the claim should be told as to the real requirements to make out a bundle of facts which establish the right of the parties and where the infringement has happened. And that has to be all these, according to me, even with literate claims who have no time nowadays, and illiterate claims you find hapless. It is the duty of the legal practitioners. It is the primary duty of the legal practitioners to see that the rigors of Rule 11 of Order 7 CPC is not attracted, and their effort of presenting a plaint or a petition is not nipped in the bud. This Article 7, Rule 11 not only applies to suits, even to writ petitions also. This alternate remedy, many a times writ petitions are permitted to withdraw to avail the alternative remedy. Why? If it had been seen, except the principles of violation of the principles of natural justice, which the courts many a times exempt, rest of the things are concerned, it could be worked out under the relevant statute itself. When relief can be obtained under the relevant statutes, if not has been availed, and other forums, that is either a civil court or the high court has been approached, then it is, according to me, the deficiency on the part of our brethren or sisters, as the case may be, and that should be avoided at all costs. As far as the judicial officers who might have logged in, my observation is that you have a bounden obligation to analyze the plaint, read the arguments or the statements made in the plaint as a whole and in entirety, find out whether they constitute material facts and the invasion of rights of the person who has approached the court. If they are lacking, cause of action is not there, and if there is any bar of law to entertain the suit, you have no other option than to reject the plaintiff's concern. While doing so, be very cautious in dealing with matters, because many a times in the client having approached the lawyer at the last hour and there being no time left for the lawyer even to do his professional work, the plaint has been presented. If a way out can be found out, take the case to trial rather than nipping at the bud is concerned, unless the suit is frivolous, vexatious, or scandalous, as the case may be. So this is how the judicial officers have to take into consideration, or the courts have to take into consideration. However, my advice to my brethren and sisters are that, meaning thereby to the members of the legal fraternity practicing before the courts, are to see to it that there is no deficiency on their part in drafting the plaint is concerned and presenting it before the proper court and its prosecution, to take the suit for trial and invite the court for a final judgment. So this is how the matter has to be dealt with. There is plenty of case law, and I do not want to burden all of you with these case laws are concerned. What is relevant for our discussion in a short period, I have brought it to your notice. Please make use of it to the extent possible. And if there is any questions or any clarification to be seek, a sort, I am ready to assist to the possible extent. Thank you.
It was excellent and truly educative, sir. Thanks for the courtesy extended to Daksha Legal and its members. Before opening question and answer session, with the permission of the distinguished speaker, let me quote a few judgments already posted on Daksha Legal, because what I do is I go to Supreme Court website every day, and about 10 to 15 judgments are posted every day, sometimes 5 to 6. I go through the judgments and find out the relevant judgments, and I'll post it. Now, recently, which I can see from 2018, couple of judgments, head notes only I will give. Now, 2017, there is one judgment of the Supreme Court. You should see the Daksha Legal Facebook group. Even clear case of res judicata is not a ground for rejection of the plaint. Only plaint arguments have to be seen for rejection of the plaint. This is already posted.
Res judicata is not a pure question of law.
Yes,
it is,
yes,
a mixed question of fact and law. It is required to be pleaded as well as proved. And how do you prove it? By production of the earlier pleadings, by production of the earlier judgment, all that has to come on record.
Yes, sir. And there is one judgment.
And that will be mostly, yes, that will be a defense of the other side. Res judicata, yes, would normally be a defense. Okay. That means it becomes a part of the written statement.
Yes, sir.
No part of return statement can be looked into at this stage.
Yes, yes, sir. There is one more latest judgment of the Supreme Court, which says that DRT, of course, a suit challenging the judgment of the DRT is not maintainable. Then the...
Before I conclude, just wait a minute. There is one judgment of the Supreme Court.
Yes, sir.
That is reported in 2019, 7 SCC, page 158.
Yes, sir.
Madhav versus Axis Bank.
Yes, yes.
2019, 7 SCC, 158.
Yes.
Madhav versus Axis Bank. With 11 paragraphs are 6 and 10. It refers to an earlier recent judgment again, 2018, 11 SCC, 780.
Yes.
This is helpful. Claim cannot be rejected against one or more defendants and retained against others are concerned.
Yes.
Either
yes.
It has to go lock, stock and barrel,
yes,
or not.
It has cannot to be rejected in part.
In part. These two judgments.
Yes, yes, sir.
This 2019 7 SCC 158 is the latest judgment that is by His Lordship Justice Kanvilkar and Justice Ajay Rastogi is concerned, Lordship's bench. They refer to earlier judgment of Justice Nariman and Justice Kaur, reported in 2018, 11 SCC 780.
Sir, you are referring to that Axis Bank judgment, sir?
Yes, Axis Bank is the latest judgment.
Madhav Prasad Agarwal versus Axis Bank Limited, decided on 1st July 2019, Justice A.M. Kanvilkar, Justice Ajay Rastogi.
Yeah.
That I have already posted the judgment on 1st July 2019. As I can see from the website of the Supreme Court judgment, the latest judgment of the Supreme Court is that a suit for cancellation of the sale deed on the ground that full sale consideration had not been paid.
That is by a two judge bench, whereas the earlier judgments,
yes, sir,
are by three judges bench. If it becomes a disputed question of fact,
yes,
it's a question of limitation.
No, this is a suit for cancellation of the sale deed on the ground that full consideration had not been paid.
No, that is
the unpaid vendor's right is only for recovery of the money. Therefore, such a suit for cancellation of the sale deed on the ground that full sale consideration was not paid is not maintainable. This is dated 9th July 2020.
Nahibain versus Arvind Pai.
Yes, sir.
By Justice Nageshwar Rao and Justice Indu Malhotra.
Yes, 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 sir. Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. Author of the judgment is Justice Indu Malhotra.
Yes, yes, sir. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Now, I open the question and answer session. Kindly raise your hand so that I can ask you to pose the question directly to the learned speaker.
I'm happy to see number of my old friends, Varadarajan, Satyanarayan Gupta, Ramesh, Putige Ramesh. Putige Ramesh, I have not seen him after my demitting the office.
Mr. Putige Ramesh, sir, is here.
Yeah, Putige Ramesh is also there. So we live close by, but we never had the occasion to meet each other.
Sir, there is one question from my side.
Yeah.
Can barred by law, can it be interpreted as barred by a judgment, sir? For example, many suits were dismissed on the ground that on the basis of Prakash versus Kulwati, for example, where ultimately the Supreme Court had to concede what you had to say in Pushpalata. The Supreme Court corrected itself. Now, my question is, for example, if some plaints are rejected on the ground that the Karta was not allowed
to take advantage of Order 7 Rule 13,
yes,
it doesn't preclude you from maintaining one more suit.
Yes, sir. That is most of us, frankly speaking, I was not aware of that judgment of the Supreme
Court. And I gave you a citation of the Supreme Court report in 1997, 10 SCC.
Even that seven judgment, that even without issuing the notice to the other side, the plaint can be rejected.
Yes.
That I had not seen, sir. Therefore, if the plaint was rejected on the ground that the Karta was not alive in 2005, a fresh suit can be filed now.
Yeah, because rule 13 doesn't preclude the filing of a fresh suit.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
As far as these partition suits, which were rejected with reference to the judgments of the Supreme Court is concerned, I would suggest all of the persons who have suffered such adverse orders to make use of Rule 13,
yes,
of Order 7 and
yes,
make an independent suit.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Mr. Gupta, sir, kindly, yes. Mr. Gupta, sir, you can ask the question, sir.
Yes, sir. Wonderful presentation, sir. You have taken as too many provisions, many sections, many orders. Now, you have cautioned the advocates, you have cautioned the judges also. Now, I am requesting your lordship to the Order 7, Rule 9.
Yes.
That is it not the duty of the court to read the plan before ordering the summons?
It is. It is the duty of the court. It has to. It need not issue summons at all. It need not even register the suit. It can be rejected without even registration also.
Seven judges bench.
That is the law. But
applying in Sanju Reddy's case.
Yes. Sanju Reddy's case. But here, Guptare, Tave Nodidre, Nam courts Yav Riti flood agide anta.
Overburden.
Yav judge time ide astella nododakke. ಎದುರುಗಡೆ ಅವ್ರು ಬಂದು ಬೊಬ್ಬೆ ಹಾಕಿದಾಗ ಅದಕ್ಕೂ ಏನು ಎರಡರ್ ಮೂರು ಅರ್ಜೆಂಟ್ಮೆಂಟ್ ಕೊಟ್ಟು ಆಮೇಲೆ ಎಲ್ಲೋ ಒಂದ್ ಕಡೆ ಜಾಸ್ತಿ ಬೊಬ್ಬೆ ಆಯ್ತು ಅಂತ ಹೇಳಿ ಆಯ್ತಪ್ಪ ತಗೊಳ್ತೀನಿ ಅಂತ ತಗೊಂಡು ಡಿಸೈಡ್ ಮಾಡ್ತಾರೆ. ದೇ ಆರ್ ರಿಯಲಿ ಸಫರಿಂಗ್ ಮಿಸ್ ಗುಪ್ತಾ, ನಾನು ಹೇಳ್ತೀನಿ ಕೇಳಿ. ಲುಕಿಂಗ್ ಫ್ರಮ್ ದಿಸ್ ಸೈಡ್ ದಿ ಗ್ರಾಸ್ ವಾಸ್ ಲುಕಿಂಗ್ ವೆರಿ ಗ್ರೀನರ್. ವೆನ್ ಯು ಗೋ ದೇರ್ ದೆನ್ ಓನ್ಲಿ ಯು ನೋ ವಾಟ್ ಅನ್ ಅಮೌಂಟ್ ಆಫ್ ಪ್ರೆಷರ್ ಈಸ್ ದೇರ್.
ಯು ಕ್ಯಾನ್ ಅಂಡರ್ಸ್ಟ್ಯಾಂಡ್ ದಿ ಪಿಂಚ್.
ಡೆಫಿನೆಟ್ಲಿ ಹೌ ಇಟ್ ಕ್ರಶ್ ಯು. See, nanu heltini, it's not about myself. I was speaking to one judge who was my colleague here. He was reading only Kannada newspaper in the morning, and to read English newspaper he had reserved his time for evening tea. While having tea with his wife in the evening, he used to see what the English newspaper carries, and rightly he has made up to the Honorable Supreme Court. That is the dedication the man had. I also followed him in certain footsteps are concerned.
Wonderful.
He availed, for your information, I'll not name the learned judge, he availed just 1.5 days leave in a career which spent about 14 years.
Wonderful.
And one day, because of his mother passed away, and he has to perform the ritual. Great. That is the kind of devotion the judges have. Don't take out the name, please. Nobody.
No, okay. Thank you. I will not take the name, sir.
Yes, nobody. I request nobody to take out the name of the learned judges, because they are still sitting judges.
Okay. Thank you, sir. Thank you. Thank you, Basavaraj, for giving me the opportunity. Okay.
Wonderful. Mayura, this age also, you are so enthusiastic of participating in all these webinars and still showing interest to carry forward the profession.
No, Basavaraj was telling me, Yeshwar Shai sir, this is my 50th year, I told him.
Yeah. By the time we entered the bar, Mr. Gupta was a seasoned advocate.
Thank you, sir. Thank you for the observations.
Yes.
Thank you, Basavaraj.
Mr. Mayura? Mayur Kirti?
Yes, sir.
You sir. Wanted to ask a question?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
ಏನು ಪ್ರಶ್ನೆ, ನಿಮ್ ಪ್ರಶ್ನೆ ಕೇಳಿ ಸರ್. ಅವರಿಗೆ
ಸರ್ ಗುಡ್ ಈವ್ನಿಂಗ್ ಸರ್.
ಗುಡ್ ಈವ್ನಿಂಗ್
ಸರ್. ದ ಕ್ವಶನ್ ಇಸ್ ದಟ್ ಇಫ್ ದಿ ವಿತ್ ರಿಗಾರ್ಡಿಂಗ್ ದ ಲಿಮಿಟೇಷನ್ ಇಸ್ ಕನ್ಸರ್ನ್ ದ ಲಾ ಆಫ್ ಲಿಮಿಟೇಷನ್ ಸೆಕ್ಷನ್ 7 ಕ್ಲೋಸ್ 11 ಡಿ ಕೆಳಗಡೆ ಸರ್ ವಾಟ್ ಇಸ್ ಬಾರ್ಡ್ ಬೈ ಲಾ ಆಫ್ ಲಿಮಿಟೇಷನ್ ಅಂತ ಇದ್ದಾಗ ಸರ್, ಈಗ ಲೇಟೆಸ್ಟ್ ಜಡ್ಜ್ಮೆಂಟ್ ದಟ್ ಈಸ್ ಆಫ್ ಸುಪ್ರೀಂ ಕೋರ್ಟ್ ರಾಮ್ ಪ್ರಸಾದ್ ರಾಘವೇಂದ್ರ ಶರಣ್ ಸಿಂಗ್ ವರ್ಸಸ್ ರಾಮ್ ಪ್ರಸಾದ್ ಸಿಂಗ್ ರಾಮ್ ಪ್ರಸನ್ನ ಸಿಂಗ್ that March 2019 decision. Sir, adralli iga question of law of limitation anna mixed question of law and facts. Sir, adanna adu idru kuda sir idanna law of limitation kelagade order 7 rule 11 d kelagade waja madabodu ant heli earlier eradu judgment anandre plaint everment an noduvagle law of limitation barred anta untu ant idre reject madabodu ant helide.
Snehitre, if it is ex facie apparent, as has been discussed in that Dahi Bain versus Arvind Bal, 2020 SEC Online 562, Justice Nageshwar Rao and Justice Indomulathra judgment, the facts are so clear. The relief, one of the relief sought is cancellation of a sale deed.
Yes.
Executed at a certain point of time, the suit having been instituted long after expiry of the period of limitation. Ex facie. No trial is required at all. From the reading of the plain governments and the documents, it was ex facie barred by limitation, because the specific relief sought is cancellation of a sale deed on account of what? Non-payment of the full consideration amount.
Sir.
If full consideration is not paid, your relief is only for recovery of the balance consideration in respect of the bones checks are not presented checks, expiry checks, whatever it is. Here, my question is the relief.
Yes.
Suppose it is a disputed question of fact and daga. There are plenty of judgments which say it has to go for trial. It cannot be rejected. And the latest one I read out to you was 2020 SEC online, that is Shakti Bhog Food Industries versus Central Bank of India.
Sir.
2020 SEC online SC 482, particularly para 21. It says, further, the factum of suit being barred by limitation, ordinarily, that is what they say, ordinarily, would be a mixed question of fact and law. Even for that reason, invoking of Order 7, Rule 11 CPC is ruled out. This is by three judges bench. And this is the latest law. So as far as disputed questions, no. A trial, issue has to be raised. It has to go for trial.
Mr. Puthiah Ramesh, sir, you wanted to ask a question?
Agidiri Ramesh.
Puthiah Ramesh. ಅಪ್ಪವರು
ಮ್ಯೂಟ್ ಮಾಡಿದಾರ
ನೋಡ್ತಾರೇನೆ
ಇಲ್ಲ ಏನೋ
ಬೇರೆ ಯಾರಾದರೂ ಕ್ವೆಶ್ಚನ್ಸ್ ಇದ್ರೆ ಕೇಳ್ಬೋದು ಟುಡೇ ಇಟ್ ವಾಸ್ ಹೌಸ್ಫುಲ್ ಅಂಡ್ ಇಟ್ ಸಬ್ಜೆಕ್ಟ್ ಮೇಲೆ ಹೋಗುತ್ತೆ ಸರ್ ಕೆಲಸ ಸರಿ ಡಿಪೆಂಡಿಂಗ್ ಆನ್ ದಿ